Okay, good morning for those of you in the United States. Good evening for those of you in Asia, and good day for those of you all around the world. Thank you for joining us. My name is Victor Cha. I'm the D.S. Song K.F. Professor of Government and Vice Dean at the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University. And we welcome you to our dialogue today. This dialogue is a part of the Project on Strategic Dialogue in the Asia Pacific, co-sponsored by Georgetown's Asian Studies Program in the Wall School of Foreign Service and the Initiative for U.S. China Dialogue on Global Issues. The topic today is a pretty simple one, North Korea. What we plan to do in the next 90 minutes that we have together is solve the North Korea problem for the United States and China. So it's not a very large or difficult task. I hope everybody has their coffee ready, because we're going to need as many synapses firing as we can possibly get firing over the course of our time together. I'm procrastinating here a little bit to give a chance for folks to log on and be with us. I'm seeing the numbers kind of stabilizing now. So what I'd like to do is to formally introduce our guests for the dialogue this morning. And I will go in alphabetical order. So we have joining us from Philadelphia, Avery Goldstein. Avery Goldstein is the David M. Knott Professor of Global Politics and International Relations in the Department of Political Science at the University of Pennsylvania. He is also the inaugural director of the Center for the Study of Contemporary China and associate director of the Christopher H. Brown Center for International Politics at the University of Pennsylvania. For all of you students out there who've done any work on Asia or international relations, you will know him well from his voluminous publications in IR, security studies, and of course, China. A good and old friend, Avery, thank you so much for joining us today. we have next Gene Lee. Gene Lee is a Pulitzer-nominated veteran foreign correspondent and expert on North Korea, who currently serves now as the director of the Hyundai Motor Korea Foundation Center for Korean History and Public Policy at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars. Gene led the Associated Press news agency's coverage of the Korean Peninsula as bureau chief from 2008 to 2013. And most importantly, in 2011, she became the first American journalist granted extensive access on the ground in North Korea. And in January 2012, opened the Associated Press's Pyongyang bureau. And Jean, thank you. Jean is in Seoul, I believe, and she's joining us from Seoul. So good evening, Jean. Thank you for being with us. Next, we have Sidney Seiler. Sid is the National Intelligence Officer for North Korea at the National Intelligence Council. Previously, he served as U.S. Forces Korea Senior Analyst and Senior Defense Intelligence Expert for North Korea, serving as the Principal Advisor and Senior Expert on Korean Peninsula security issues to the U.S. Forces Korea Commander and the U.S. Defense Intelligence Enterprise. Sid served as the U.S. Special Envoy for six-party talks from 2014 to 2015, where he coordinated U.S. diplomacy and policy on North Korea and led the negotiations with North Korea. And prior to that, Sid served as Director of Korea on the National Security Council during the Obama administration from 2011 to 2014. So rarely do we have someone who has both intelligence expertise and policy expertise on North Korea. So we're very happy to have Sid with us. Sid is in it this morning. Sid is in an undisclosed location, so he can join us by audio, but he can't join us by video. So Sid, thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Victor.
And then we have Tong Zhao, who is a senior fellow in the nuclear policy program at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, based in Beijing at the Carnegie Tsinghua Center for Global Policy. He serves on the board of directors of the Asia Pacific Leadership Network for Nuclear Nonproliferation and Disarmament, and on the advisory board of the Missile Defense Initiative. Dr. Zhao is also an associate editor of Science and Global Security and is a member of the International Panel on Fissile Materials. Dr. Zhao, thank you for joining us. Are you in Beijing now?
Yes, I'm in Beijing, and thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us. So, and it's so late in the evening there, so thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. Okay, so why don't we begin our discussion? What we'll do is we'll spend, you know, about 10 or 12 minutes on a set of different topics, about three or four different topics, and then we'll go to questions from the audience as they come in. And so where I thought, given the topic today is about North Korea and U.S.-China relations, I thought we can't really start out this discussion without having some sense of what is the state of play in North Korea today. You know, we've had the Workers' Party Congress in which there were some very candid statements with regard to the economic situation and also some very clear statements with regard to North Korean intentions in terms of its weapons program. I think Fitch Ratings reported that the economy in 2020 has registered negative growth rates on the order that we saw during the mid 1990s in the famine years, the great famine years. And then in the summer, we had all this flooding that took place, unprecedented flooding that took place in North Korea, that which did not augur well for the food situation in the country. So what I thought I'd do is first go to Sid and Jean to get their sense of what they think the situation is in North Korea. Is it as dire as people are saying, or what is your view on this? And Toya reminded me, for the audience, if you have questions, you can submit your questions by email to uschinadialogue@georgetown.edu. So uschinadialogue, all one word, @georgetown.edu. So Sid, maybe I could go to you first and you can give us your laydown of what on any aspect of that, how do you see the situation, the Workers' Party Congress, the economic and food situation, the political situation. So Sid, over to you.
Thank you, Victor. You know, let's take the tactical situation on the ground and then maybe talk about the strategic picture that the Eighth Party Congress revealed. You know, North Korea clearly has been suffering under the pressure of sustained sanctions, particularly tied to their 2017 missile launches that were the first ones that began to, first sanctions that really began to expand beyond the WMD program themselves into sectoral areas with the intent to, you know, impede North Korea's access to foreign currency, punish it for its activities, and bring Kim Jong-un back to the negotiating table, leading Kim to the point where he would conclude, at least within that might not be the intent of the Security Council resolutions, but our overall pressure strategy that through sustained pressure, Kim would conclude that his nuclear program is more of a burden than an asset. And of course, North Korea has got a long history of dealing with you know, shortages, isolation. It is a country that self-isolates in many ways. So when you throw sanctions on top of that, you have a country that's already somewhat equipped with coping mechanisms. And we saw this particularly in the 1990s, food shortages, you know, famine, malnutrition, and the regime just plowed through that under the phrase the arduous march, acknowledging that the policy decisions that it was making would result in isolation and hardship and a protracted period in which economic development would have to be put on the back burner as nuclear and other defense programs were pursued. And then you throw on top of that, as you mentioned, the typhoons, the bad weather damage, any given year in North Korea, because of what it's done over time to its land, poor farming methods, insufficient infrastructure, every year is either a famine or a flood. And so in that regard, you know, the typhoons were bad, but not unprecedented. But then you throw on top of this COVID. And, you know, the challenge with COVID, given the opaque nature of North Korean society, is it's really difficult to have an understanding fully of the extent to which the disease itself is spread. But what's clear is that in response to it, the regime has taken some very dramatic measures in their anti-epidemic efforts, closing the borders, limiting travel inside in a way that, you know, it exacerbates the already existing problems that they had. You know, but all of this, I think perhaps more importantly, needs to be looked at within the strategic direct trajectory of the North. You know, in 2018, as they ended their missile nuclear testing of 2017, engaged in a year of diplomacy where Kim received very limited benefits from his outreach to try to lock in his nuclear status, enable sanctions relief, and begin to turn the economy around by increasing inputs. Beginning in 2019, he began to signal that the country was headed back to a period of isolation and that its defense requirements and the unique nature of the hostile environment that the regime exists in required additional belt tightening, austerity, that arduous march language laid aside. Now we're in an arduous struggle, proclaimed in a January 1st, 2020 statement, kind of wrapping up the fifth plenary session of the seventh Congress, but a proclamation that this is a way going forward. So this is going back to 2020. The future ahead will be difficult. It will be an arduous struggle. We cannot expect sanctions relief. We can not expect anything outside. If you expect anything, any help from the outside, you are a betrayer of the revolution. And it's treasonous. And so already from 2020, the North had been laying out this future that projected sustained downturn in diplomacy with the outside and kind of a hunkering down self-reliance in the Eighth Party Congress. And I won't go into it here because it's already taken too much time. And I'm sure the conversation will lead to it. And I urge all the participants in this seminar, if you have not already, go back and read the Kim Jong-un readout of the Eighth Party Congress, because in there you see North Korea's worldview. We're in a hostile world. The relentless pressure of the imperialist United States is not going to change. Therefore, we need to push forward on a number of military programs, solid fueled IBMs, SLBMs, nuclear powered submarine, hypersonic glide vehicle, a large number of capabilities, and that the security environment of the DPRK required this. We have no expectations for advances either with the United States. We have no expectations with South Korea. China's a good friend, but you know, they're not going to be there to bail us out at the end of the day. He didn't say that precisely, but the tone of the Eighth Party Congress kind of represented that the tactical environment that we just talked about, the hardships, the COVID, the flooding, is a natural state that North Korea has equipped itself to survive in for the near future. So on the one hand, things don't look good, but on the other hand, we see no indications of regime instability, of a softening of their negotiating picture because of the hardships they're under. And so the situation doesn't look unfamiliar to those of us who have watched this for a number of years. It's bleak, but on the other hand, it's also one that we're very familiar with responding to and dealing with. So I think from a policy perspective, as a new administration comes in and envisions the realm of the possible, these are all very familiar issues and very familiar situation that the new administration will be tackling.
Great, thanks. And that's a terrific lay down of the overall situation. Great analysis of the Workers' Party Congress. Can I ask you just one follow-up question? And that is, you ended by saying that they don't look like they're softening up for negotiations, but at the same time, the situation is difficult but stable. I mean, in your experience, you know, studying this country for as long as you have, and then both on outside the government and then inside the government, and being involved on the in the policy side, actually negotiating with North Korea during six-party talks and during the Obama administration, if you had to posit, like, what are the conditions under which they become more open to negotiation? Like, if you had to posit, like, what sort of conditions lead them to negotiation versus the period now where they look like they're pretty hardened in, you know, kind of dug in and certainly don't look like they're softening anytime soon? Is there any way to generalize, like, what sort of conditions are conducive to negotiation versus they're not being interested in it?
So, you know, if you separate the question of when North Korea is prepared tactically to engage in dialogue towards the goal of advancing the nuclear program by buying time, securing sanctions relief, et cetera, not when North Korea has made a decision that it's willing to explore denuclearization seriously, but if you lay aside those tactical moves in and out of charm offenses, for me, you know, the biggest dilemma we face with North Korea is understanding what threat it faces that has driven the nuclear program. Their own messaging about a hostile United States that is a nuclear threat to the peninsula, the nuclear threat posed by the United States is the rationale, the justification for the North taking this path, and that, you know, history has shown, you know, Hussein, Gaddafi, that if you don't have a nuclear weapon, the United States will overturn you. Well, history has not shown that. Okay, that's not the lesson history, you know, has given North Korea. The program goes back much further than those two instances, and it really goes back to just kind of an institutional inferiority or sense of vulnerability, that the system itself is vulnerable to pressures internal and external. Their biggest security concern is not an attack from South Korea and the United States. Their biggest security concern is that their system is vulnerable to internal pressures for change, and that one day, unable to control those pressures, outside powers may see value in intervening, or conversely, North Korea could use the threat of war to even encourage outside powers to help the Kim regime reconsolidate his power. So the reason I say that is because, you know, the conditions under which the North might consider denuclearization are the conditions under which it does not face these concerns about the frailty of their system. And that's what's so hard from our perspective, is we can provide security guarantees. We can provide an end of war declaration. We can provide economic assistance. We can build light water reactors. There's a lot of things we can do, but these carrots really don't appeal to Kim because they don't address his fundamental concern. Let me close by quoting National Security Advisor, now Foreign Minister, but then National Security Advisor of South Korea, as he comes out of Pyongyang. Chung-yong, as he comes out of Pyongyang in 2018, he says, Kim Jong-un has expressed his commitment to the denuclearization of the entire Korean Peninsula. And when the North faces no military threats, and when its systems safety is guaranteed, it would not need a single nuclear weapon. Security guarantees can address the former. That, you know, there would be no military threat to North Korea. The second one, though, that when its systems security or safety is guaranteed, is something that's really difficult to address without North Korea itself changing in a way that the party is able to provide a better future for the people of North Korea, and it doesn't have these standing existential concerns. that sounds very negative, but it also leaves open the prospects that one day Kim will develop that confidence. It's hard to imagine that today, but never say never.
Thanks, Sid. That was terrific. Yes, and we in fact did provide external security guarantees to North Korea in the six-party talks. I mean, we were both there when the six-party talks produced a statement that said the United States will not attack North Korea with nuclear or conventional weapons, right? In writing, that statement was there. But your points about the concerns about the regime are well taken. All right, let me go to Gene now to pick up where Sid left off. So Gene, so while Sid in 2012 was working on this issue in Washington, D.C., you were in Pyongyang at the time, seeing it from the other side. If you'd like to pick up on any, and especially if you have any, there's been a lot of speculation, myself included, about the COVID situation in North Korea, the food situation, the economic situation. On any of these, please feel free to pick up on any of these threads. So over to you, Gene.
So thank you to Sid for really doing the hard job and setting the scene and laying things out, but I'll just add a few things. I think that border closure is really significant in this. It's been a year, it's been more than a year now since they closed the border. And what that means is that not only is trade largely not getting in and out, we're starting to see the figures. The South Korean Trade Association put the rate of trade as having dropped 80%, trade with China as having dropped 80% in 2020 compared to 2019. But also, we simply can't see what's happening there without, and this is particularly hard for me as somebody who spent a lot of time inside North Korea, because I know that how they portray their society, their strength, their stability in their state media is very different than the way it feels on the ground. And so not having people on the ground, whether it's journalists, foreign diplomats, aid workers, to give us a sense of what things are like day to day and not just the best bits that they like to project, makes it hard for us to really get a feel for what's happening. But I can tell you that given the border closure, the sanctions, the lack of goods going in and out, the lack of medicine going in and out, that life is extremely difficult in North Korea. This is a country that is 85% mountains, can't grow much of its own food. As Sid mentioned earlier, terrible agricultural practices, just simply doesn't have the resources to grow enough food to feed its people. And so it does rely on help from the outside world. And they're not allowing that help in. So I think we're starting to see statistics and estimates as well about food insecurity and that number going up. So I can tell you, even in the best of times, I was there during what would probably be called some of the best of times when Kim Jong-un was coming to power and they spared no expense in really rolling out the red carpet for him. It was still incredibly tough. And you don't see that, you don't feel it if you're not there. I can only imagine how difficult it is in the dead of winter in North Korea right now, even in Pyongyang. So just to say that I think we can safely assume that things are difficult. About the Workers' Party Congress, I looked at the text that came out from state media and I found it terrifying, to be honest. As somebody who spent a lot of time reading between the lines, it was essentially one big self-criticism session. Aside from laying out very clearly that they were going to keep building nuclear weapons, Kim Jong-un also assigned blame on the people themselves instead of taking responsibility in a sense for the decisions that led them to the sanctions and to being isolated and cut off from the outside world, kind of turned it on the people and said, listen, you're all to blame. And I found that absolutely terrifying knowing what that means for the people of North Korea. But he had to lay out that scene and make clear what the policy is, because frankly, I think he spent 2020, and perhaps this is partly why he shut the border and wanted to keep prying eyes out, trying to regroup and come up with a new strategy. The big gamble that he took in 2019 with the summit diplomacy with President Trump did not pan out. And we often talk about how it didn't work out in terms of denuclearization. There was not an iota of denuclearization as a result of that diplomacy. But it was a big loss for Kim Jong-un as well. I do think that the North Koreans, the people, as well as the leadership, were looking forward to a very different economic landscape if a nuclear deal had included the lifting of some of those sanctions that have really taken a bite on their economy. And I'm just going to mention, I look at a lot of primary sources, of course, from my time in North Korea. I spent a lot of time buying books, and I find it very useful to see what their publications are. So I did take a look at a commodities catalog that the North Koreans published in early 2019, and it's so hopeful. It is a fat book that is glossy and filled with everything from toothpaste to tins of butter cookies and widescreen TVs. And the captions are written in Chinese. So it's very clear that they were looking forward to a very different economic landscape had things gone differently. And so you think about all those people who were told we're going to ramp up trade with China. And then to have to come back from Hanoi and say, sorry, it didn't work out. It took him, I think, a good chunk of 2019 and 2020 to rejigger his strategy and figure out what kind of messaging he was going to send to the people. And the message is, we're not ready. We're not ready to make peace with the United States. We still need those weapons. He clearly feels that he needs more weapons, a stronger weapons program, so that when he does get to that negotiating table again, he's in a stronger position. When you talk about what conditions would draw the North Koreans to negotiations, I think he absolutely needs for his nuclear weapons to pay off. And that means that he holds on to his nuclear weapons in order to secure his place, but that he's able to sell off pieces of his nuclear program in exchange for lifting of sanctions and other concessions. So I do think that those are the conditions from my point of view for how you would get him back to the negotiating table. But in the meantime, as we work out what the US strategy is going to be, work with partners in the region to try to figure out if we can find some common ground, you can bet that they're going to continue to work on that program so that when they come to the table, they're going to be in a stronger position. Let's see, was there anything else that in terms of the healthcare situation you were asking about? I spent a lot of time in hospitals in North Korea, and I can tell you that they simply do not have the infrastructure to handle any kind of a pandemic. I mean, frankly, we can't handle one in the United States. And they have, it's almost like going back in time when you go into a North Korean hospital. The hospitals I've been to, and the last time was in 2017, many of them don't have running water. I have a picture that I shared just the other day of water basins. And can you imagine being in a hospital in this day and age? It's like going back to the 1800s. We're in a hospital where germs and bacteria are prevalent. You're using a standing water basin to wash your hands. So there's no heat and electricity except inside the surgery. And there are certain hospitals, very elite hospitals, where they've definitely modernized and upgraded. But I would say for the most part, the healthcare system is stuck in the 1960s and 70s. And so they simply would not be able to handle an outbreak. And they know that. And so most of their medicine is preventative. Even in this catalog that I mentioned, it was all preventative. It was all ginseng. It was all natural, what we would call hanyak in South Korea, oriental medicine. There was nothing in there to suggest that they had medicine that we use in the Western world that would resolve disease. It's just designed to prevent it. So I do think that that's a real concern, but I think there's an ulterior motive to shutting the border, and that is to keep people from coming in and keep people from going out during this period when they really need to kind of batten down the hatches, solidify their sense of unity. He needed to work on his, Kim Jong-un needed to work on his standing with the people. And then that is part of the reason why they shut down the border. Victor, was there something else you wanted me to talk about?
No, or? If I could just, that's terrific, Gene. It's very interesting and very vivid images in what you've described, which is, I guess, why you're an award-winning journalist. but can I just pick up the question is, we don't know what's happening inside the country. We just hear bits and pieces of how COVID is affecting the country. As you said, the border is closed now. It's been over a year since the border has been closed. And, you know, I have not talked to anybody that predicts they're going to open that border anytime soon, like anytime soon. And so I guess the follow-up is, so how long can they do that, right? How long can they stay closed like that? Like, as you said, in Hanoi, you know, the big gamble was to try to get sanctions relief. But even if they were offered sanctions relief now, it wouldn't mean much because their border is shut down and they're not letting things in. Like, stuff is sitting on the border and rotting because it can't. There's medicine that's sitting on the border and literally rotting, expiring, because they won't let it in. So, you know, first, I guess, how long will they stay shut down? You know, Sid talked about how resilient this place is despite its horrible conditions. I mean, how resilient can a system like this be when it closes itself off from the world even more than it normally would?
Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely true. They have remarkable coping mechanisms. I've seen them do so much with very little. They don't throw anything out. They will use everything, things that we would have thrown away decades ago. So they're incredibly resourceful. That said, I think that the longer that the border is officially closed, the more North Korea is going to be looking at illicit ways. I don't think that means that things are not getting in and out. I think that there are ways that they are getting things and goods into the country. But I think they're going to be looking at more illicit means, whether it's some of the satellite imagery showing offshore ship-to-ship transfers. And I would say cyber is a major threat. Remember that this cyber is not a place that is bound by borders. Cyberspace is totally wide open. And we don't know how many North Korean cyber hackers stayed in China, for example, but they can easily do that from Pyongyang as well. And so I think that we'll start to see them finding different ways, different illicit means to bring that money in, even if they don't open that border. I do, of course, for the people of North Korea, worry about what a protracted border closure would mean when they don't have access to food, medicine, the goods and products that they need to farm, to run their factories, obviously fuel. But I think they're getting a lot of the basics of what they need in other ways, and we just can't see it. We just don't have a good view into it. And I don't think official trade data and customs data reflect what's really happening in terms of the economy.
Thanks, Gene. Terrific. Dr. Zhao and Dr. Goldstein have been very patient, so let me move to them now and pick up with some of the statements we saw in the Workers' Party Congress about North Korea's intentions with regard to the weapons program. Sid sort of enumerated the wide variety of things that they want to achieve. Dr. Zhao is an expert on nuclear policy. Perhaps, Dr. Zhao, I can go to you and ask you, what is your read of the overall state of the weapons program in North Korea? And what did you think of this laundry list of things that they would like to acquire going forward? So Dr. Zhao, over to you.
Well, thank you. I think the Ace Party Congress report in its nuclear part really sent some very important signals. If you look at all the previous progress North Korea has made in the previous 5 years period in improving its nuclear capabilities, the progress was very impressive. North Korea developed the world's largest liquid fueled road mobile ICBM, as well as its launcher. It has developed multiple theater range missile systems and is working on submarine launched ballistic missiles. But more importantly, looking forward, Kim Jong-un also declared plans for future development. And those include, solid field ICBMs, SLBMs, multiple warhead technologies, and even cutting edge capabilities like hypersonic vehicles. I think those really drive home the point that North Korea is looking at a long-term plan to maintain the credibility of its nuclear deterrent for the infinite future. North Korea understands that its enemies, especially United States, will continue building up missile defense capabilities to counter North Korea's nuclear deterrent. So it has to constantly improving, modernizing its nuclear forces and all the new capabilities North Korea is planning to develop is basically in the direction of helping ensure the credibility of its nuclear deterrence. The implication of that, I think, is very significant. I don't think North Korea has any interest in giving up its nuclear weapons anytime soon. And even if we look at arms control options to deal with North Korea in the future, the space for negotiation with North Korea on arms control issues may also be quite limited. I'm not sure if Kim Jong-un is still committed to the Hanoi deal in the sense that North Korea would suspend the Yongbyon complex in return for substantial sanction relief. I'm not sure Kim Jong-un is today still committed to that type of deal. So any future efforts to even limit and constrain North Korea's further nuclear development would be very hard to make progress. I'm particularly worried about the fact that North Korea is simultaneously developing and improving strategic nuclear weapons and tactical nuclear weapons. In the strategic capabilities, we mentioned about solid field ICBMs, MIRVing, multiple warhead technologies. If North Korea continues down the road, it will have a very negative impact on the strategic stability relations among the major powers, among U.S., Russia, China, because the U.S. Will be forced to improve its missile defense. And to respond to that, China and Russia will very likely to further improve their own nuclear weapon capabilities. And also, given that North Korea is quickly developing new missile systems, it has a very strong internal technical need to resume flight testing of these missile systems in order to make sure they work and also to demonstrate to its potential enemies that its deterrent is credible. So I worry that this means North Korea resuming of longer range missile test may be a matter of time. But also, of course, whether North Korea will do that is also affected by its domestic situation, including its economic troubles within the country. And regarding North Korea's tactical nuclear weapons, I think that's the part we really need to pay attention to. Because with this capability, North Korea basically is now capable of threatening the use of tactical nuclear weapons in a conventional conflict in this region. And also use its strategic nuclear weapons to deter the U.S. from launching any nuclear retaliation, even after North Korea uses nuclear weapons first. So it basically gives North Korea the option of first use of nuclear weapons without worrying about consequences of nuclear retaliation. I think this will create real threat perception in South Korea and in Japan, and may further motivate some experts in these countries to consider their own nuclear hedge options. So I don't think the picture is pretty. It has real long-term implications for both regional and international security.
Well, thanks, Dr. Zhao. That's a very sobering laydown of the of the situation and a great deal of concern of what, not just what the North Koreans are doing, but what the sort of knock-on effects are that. And I think if I could pick up on the tail end of something you said and go to Avery Goldstein, you know, one of the things that Dr. Zhao pointed out was that as North Korea improves these capabilities, which compels a U.S. response in order to enhance and improve the credibility of its deterrent posture in the region, that is then going to cause China and Russia to react. And so that takes me to Avery, where I wanted to use that thread and sort of first ask you about the whether you see continuity or change in U.S.-China relations from Trump to Biden. And then you can also talk if you wish, about what do you think that China's goals are on the Korean Peninsula, given what Dr. Zhao has just explained. So Avery, over to you.
Sure, thanks, Victor. I'll try to be very brief, so we have plenty of time for the audience to ask questions. Let me take that in two parts. First, this question of continuity and change. I would even extend my response, if you'll let me, beyond Trump and say it probably pays to think about the fact that, you know, when the six-party talks got off the ground almost a couple decades ago, we were in a different world and North Korea had a fundamentally different set of capabilities. So in the past few years and going forward, we're in a world, first of all, where, as Zhao Tung pointed out, that North Korea is a nuclear weapons state. It's not going to give up its nuclear weapons capability, may be willing to negotiate on the edges. The other big change in this situation is the fundamental deterioration of U.S.-China relations, which means that if there's going to be some kind of resumption of diplomacy to try to address the kinds of questions people are concerned about, that it's going to have to take place in a context where it's probably going to be even more difficult than it was in the early 21st century to get the United States and China on the same page in addressing the situation in North Korea. And as far as the shift from Trump to the Biden administration, I think that we're not seeing, all signals are that we're not going to see a fundamental change in the approach taken by the Biden administration in U.S.-China relations. I think it seems as though they're devoting efforts to try to kind of lay the groundwork, prepare things. They're in no hurry to try to reach out to China, certainly in a way that would make it seem as though the United States is especially eager, even on high priority issues other than North Korea, like fighting climate change and fighting the pandemic. We don't yet see any serious effort to launch an initiative with China. And so I think this other area of traditional U.S.-China, at least overlapping interests, trying to manage the difficulties in North Korea and on the Korean Peninsula, there's even a lower incentive for the United States and perhaps for China to think that this is an issue that should bring us together and we should be cooperating on this. So I think the fundamental deterioration in U.S.-China relations is really troubling in terms of the ability to be optimistic about the situation on the peninsula. One other element of continuity, however, is one that Zhao Tung brought up, which is that even in the early 21st century, when the six-party talks were getting started, China was clearly concerned that the United States was viewing the North Korean incipient nuclear capability and its missile capability as a reason for the United States to thicken its missile defenses in the region, ship-based missiles at the time and ground-based missiles in the United States. And I think if anything, that point has that concern on the part of the Chinese and the implications for the viability of China's own nuclear deterrent were reinforced by the whole THAAD experience, even though many of us in the West believe that China's concerns about the THAAD system in South Korea were exaggerated. I think it reflected a serious, broader concern about missile defense, which is of long standing, and that China sees as a link to this question of how the Americans will respond to North Korea's nuclear and missile capabilities. And I think it's likely that the change in U.S.-China relations is going to trigger all kinds of concerns about China's role in arms control efforts going forward. We certainly saw that towards the tail end of the Trump administration, where the Trump administration insisted that the extension of the New START treaty ought to have some participation by China to bring China into the process. And I suspect that going forward, there's going to be an expectation in the United States that in some way China become involved in arms control efforts. And that, of course, will be complicated to the extent that the United States believes it's responding in the region by deploying missile defenses geared towards what it sees as a threat from North Korea. So my bottom line here is that the change in U.S.-China relations probably is making any kind of diplomatic resolution of the problem that North Korea poses even more difficult than it was in the past.
Well, thanks. Thanks, Avery. That's so essentially there's sort of, it's almost like there's a positive feedback loop here, right? I mean, there's a deterioration of U.S.-China relations. North Korea is moving further along in its capabilities. South Korea, Japan, the United States are going to thicken missile defenses and do other things, which is going to force China and others to respond. So I guess my question is there any negative feedback in this constellation of forces that you've just described? And this is for both Dr. Goldstein and Dr. Zhao. I mean, both of you have given me a picture of there's a lot of positive feedback loops in terms of the direction in which these things are moving. Is there any negative feedback to stop it from all moving in one direction as you've described? And maybe we'll go to Avery first.
Oh, okay. I was going to say I could go to Jalpo first, but all right, I'll go. I think I'm not sure whether I've got the negative and the positive lined up properly here. It reminds me when I try to jumpstart the battery in my car and I can never remember how to connect the terminals. But I think what you're saying is are there any breaks on the kind of deteriorating situation that I described? I do think so. I think that the North Korean problem is probably not at the very tippy top of the agenda for either the United States or China and its concerns in the region. Obviously, this panel's focused on the problem, but I think both for the United States and for China, in some respects, their plates are pretty full, and that this is not the most pressing concern in the bilateral relationship or even in their concerns about the security in the region. Having said that, I think one of the points I take away from the comments by Sid and Jean at the opening is just how much agency North Korea has in this situation. So however much the United States and China might want to at least temporarily set aside a focus on North Korea, that I don't want to say at any moment, but it's certainly a possibility that North Korea will do something in order to, as it's done in the past, to try to raise the visibility of the issue for its own self-interested reasons. And I think that barring that kind of action, I think the US and China are prepared to be somewhat patient. It's not as though there's a risk in being patient at this point because North Korea is going to become a nuclear weapon state. It is a nuclear weapon state. But I'll defer on the technical questions to Zhao Tong.
Dr. Zhao?
Thank you. One interesting development is both North Korea and China have drawn the conclusion that the U.S. Has a strategic intention to undermine their national interests. As North Korea said during the 8th Party Congress, as long as the imperialist countries exist in the world, they will never drop their hostile policy towards North Korea. I think China, if you read writings and comments by Chinese policy experts, they all basically agree that the U.S. is determined to harm China, to prevent China's continuous rise. I think that's very similar view, very similar interpretation in both Beijing and Pyongyang about American security intention. Is a facilitating factor in the positive loop you were referring to. But I think there are things that can be done to put some brake to the development. I think one important phenomenon is in China, I don't think the policy experts have fully understood the long-term implications of a permanent nuclear-capable North Korea. You know, there is very little public discussion about the trajectory of North Korean nuclear capability development. You know, I tried to publish something to draw attention to the very serious future plan of North Korea's nuclear program. There is nowhere to publish such a piece in China. So there is no public discussion about this issue. I don't think people have thought really deeply and systematically about how a permanent nuclear North Korea could really undermine Chinese interest by exacerbating the security dilemma between U.S. and China, and also between China and other regional countries, including South Korea, Japan, on issues of missile defense, and you know, conventional theater range missiles, etc. I think if China starts to, I think China for the past couple of years has been preoccupied by the rising U.S.-China bilateral competition and rivalry, and the strategists here haven't really thought deeply about the consequences of nuclear North Korea. And also, you know, they, if you talk to them, they tend to argue that, we can make North Korea denuclearize. I know we must insist on the goal of achieving a nuclear-free Korean Peninsula. But again, if you ask them further, what's the concrete strategy? What's the concrete Chinese leverage that can make North Korea denuclearize? I don't think they have a clear answer. So I think the first step is for some dialogue here so that China can understand the comprehensive implication, but also to understand the lack of leverage that China doesn't, that China lacks, and also the United States and the rest of the international community. They probably even
oh, I think we've lost Dr. Zhao momentarily. Well, all right. So as he tries to come back on, are you there, Dr. Zhao? Yeah, we lost,
hear you.
Yeah, we lost you for a second there.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So if you could just repeat your last point. That'd be great.
Yeah. Basically, to sum up, I think there needs to be some deep discussion here between U.S. and China and other regional countries, so that Chinese policy experts can, such dialogue can provide an opportunity for Chinese policy experts to reflect upon China's own policy. I think that can help put all the regional players on the same page in terms of how they should deal with North Korea going forward. And there are also ways that they can mitigate the impact of missile defense, et cetera. One example is Chinese experts can work with American experts to examine whether there is a sweet spot of American missile defense capability so that it could defend against North Korean ICBMs without undermining Chinese strategic deterrent capability. If they can find such a sweet spot, then they can work in that direction. But even if their conclusion is there is no such sweet spot, that conclusion would help mitigate the Chinese concern that the US is deliberately trying to undermine Chinese nuclear forces by using the North Korean excuse. So there are some ways to mitigate the positive loop, but it requires political commitment from China, US to pursue these options.
Great, thank you, very interesting. Can I go, so I wanna go do just one more quick round of questions, short answers, if you will, from our guests, and then I'd like to move to the bevy of questions that are coming up on the chat. So, and I'd like to first go back to Sid and pick up where Dr. Zhao left off. And, to the extent you can answer this, Sid, please do. To the extent you can't, you don't have to, but I mean, in your experience, like, again, you're the U.S. government's top national intelligence officer for North Korea now, but you've also worked on the policy side. You know, when we did six-party talks, there was a lot of conversation with the Chinese, and then I'm sure you worked with them during the Obama administration. To what extent do you think that what Dr. Zhao describes is a problem, that the Chinese, at least at the leadership level, don't really comprehend what the implications are of a permanent nuclearized, perhaps even modern nuclearized weapons force in North Korea means for Chinese security interests? And to what extent did you encounter that? Did you sense that, or do you think that they kind of know where they are? Sid, yeah, if we could just go for quick short answers this round, that'd be great. So Sid,
I was violently shaking my head in agreement with Dr. Chow. This has been, when you look at North Korea and you look at a capability that's emerging, you always think in terms of capabilities and intent. And you know, this issue has been marked by a kind of a denial that the North could succeed in developing a nuclear weapon, that it could succeed in enrichment, that it could succeed in creating a building an ICBM with an RV on it. And then at the end of the day, if they have it, would they really use it? And I think this is something all the parties to some degree are struggling with, is the implications of a non-denuclearizing North Korea. And I think that is going to be the key to US PRC cooperation going forward. As we sit down, we talk about that, because the implications, as Dr. Chow so rightly articulated, are profound to China. China's core security interest of a North Korea that can be more coercive, more unpredictable, more dangerous as its arsenal grows, as its options expand.
Thanks, Sid. Let me go to Avery now and ask Avery, what is your view on? I mean, you studied China and Chinese grand strategy for quite some time. Do they, in your, when you talk to academics and Chinese policymakers, do you have a sense of what Dr. Zhao described and what Sid has seen on the policy side?
Yeah, well, I think Zhao Tong is probably more sensitive to the kind of the state of the debate within China, and his concerns about perhaps not enough attention being paid to this problem is worrisome. In the past, of course, there was a lot of attention paid to it within China. But I think that your question and what Sid just said made me think about it this way, which is, maybe the question here is that all parties outside of North Korea, but including North Korea, but certainly in the United States and China, need to be thinking about what kind of North Korean capability can they live with. In other words, if the kinds of concerns that Dr. Zhao raised about North Korea developing tactical nuclear weapons, you know, it's a question of the kinds of weapons, the kinds of delivery systems that they're going to deploy. If the United States and China can agree that the idea of rolling back North Korean nuclear weapons is kind of like the grander vision of abolishing nuclear weapons in the world, which is supposedly the reason why we engage in arms control, is something that's not going to happen in the near future, that the more important focus ought to be on the type of North Korean nuclear capability the United States, China, South Korea, Japan, Russia, and others are, I don't want to say comfortable living with, but are going to be more comfortable living with than a completely unrestrained North Korean nuclear program.
Thanks. Very interesting. And then let me go to Jean for the last part of round two here. And so we haven't talked at all about South Korea. And I was wondering, Jean, if you could, you've been in Seoul for the past few months. I mean, you've watched what the Moon government is doing, their concerns, in your mind, when you look at sort of the Moon government and how they're looking at the transition from Trump to Biden, you know, what is it that they want? And can, if we talked about this positive feedback loop, can they be a break on some of this, and in what way? Jean?
Yeah, I think the president of South Korea, Moon Jae-in, he's got a little more than a year left in office. In South Korea, they have a 5-year term and that's it. And he came into office with a big, bold vision to engage North Korea. And so I think he's got a sense of impatience here. And what he would like is to for the Biden administration to maintain the momentum that they had in diplomacy in 2018. I mean, for President Moon as well, 2018 was amazing. But realistically, that's not going to happen. The Biden administration has a very different idea and approach, and they're undergoing a policy review when it comes to Korea. And so I think there's a certain amount of impatience and anxiety in Seoul in terms of inside the Blue House about what might happen to these grand visions that he had, President Moon had, when he came into office 4 years ago. If there isn't a quick review and any kind of continuity from Trump administration policy. Now, what I was watching for and what I really do think is that the most important message that South Korea could send right now to North Korea is that, listen, we stand with the United States, we stand with other countries, and that we're going to be working with the United States, and that they're not going to be working on behalf of North Korea. So we did see that President Biden and President Moon had a phone call this week, and they did discuss that they would have a coordinated response, or that they would coordinate on North Korea policy. And I think that's a good first step. I do worry, though, that there will be this sense of impatience in Seoul, that they'll be trying to push ahead before a Korea policy is fully settled in the Biden administration, and that it will be at odds with what it is the United States is seeking, and that North Korea will use that opportunity. The North Koreans are great at playing the neighbors off one another, and they would love nothing more than friction among the allies and the neighbors in the region. And I think that policy holds true for the U.S. and China. There's nothing more frightening to North Korea than when the U.S. and China come together and agree. We saw that in 2016 with the U.N. sanctions that have been so tough on the North Korean economy. When the U.S. and China are at odds, that's when North Korea can take advantage and kind of drive a wedge between both friends and foes, and really play these countries off one another. And so I really do think that right now the Biden administration priority to kind of restore alliances, try to get everybody on the same page, is probably going to be the most effective one when it comes to North Korea. And so I think they're very reassured in Seoul that they had this discussion with President Biden. And they're waiting for that phone call, not happy that he spoke to the Japanese prime minister first. But it's a good first step, and it's a good sign that hopefully they'll be more communicative than the Americans and the South Koreans were during the Trump years.
Great, thanks, Jean. Terrific. Why don't we go to our questions now? And so for the audience again, you submit your questions to uschinadialogue@georgetown.edu, uschinadialogue@georgetown.edu. And so we have a question here from Christian Wagner, who is a professor at Georgetown. And the question is, when Germany became reunited, the Bush government negotiated with the Soviet Union Germany's new status. I wonder how you'd assess China's position interest on a potentially united Korea. What conditions would you imagine China would request? And so for this, let me go to, let me ask Avery, would you like to take a shot at this?
You're going to ask me what the Chinese government would request. Well, presumably it would be that whatever the settlement is would not jeopardize China's, what they perceive as their vital national interests. In this case, it would probably be some agreement about the nature of the military relationship of the United States with whatever Korean state existed on the peninsula. We'd probably also have to say something about the kinds of military forces that would be deployed in the region and on the peninsula. So I think those would be the two principal concerns. I think the Chinese government also, maybe even on an equal par, would be wondering about whether the U.S.-Korea alliance would endure. Of course, the question of how open the new Korean state would be to continued close economic relationships with China would also be important.
Okay, and if anybody else wants to weigh in on these questions, please just put your hand up or something. I'm just putting them to one person in particular, just so we can try to get through some more of these questions. The next question is, and I guess, Gene, you kind of spoke to this, so maybe I'll go to you. The Biden administration is currently reviewing their North Korea policy. Do you have some sense of the direction of the new policy? And what do you think is important solving this 3-decade-old nuclear problem? Gene, maybe I'll go to you. Sid, I'll also offer it to you, although I don't expect that you're going to speak on an ongoing policy review. So, Gene.
If Sid wants to say something, he's more than welcome. He's very quiet.
I'd be more interested in what the policy review in Pyongyang is underway. You know, they have had golden opportunity squandered. 8 years of President Obama, who said he would open up his hand to those who would reach out his hand to those who would clench their fist. You know, 4 years of Donald Trump, who was willing to take the risk of Singapore and Hanoi. And Pyongyang has repeatedly demonstrated a failure to take the right path. And so, you know, I mean, we all know the parameters that you can imagine will be considered by the new administration. And they got a team here. We got some heavy hitters who have all worked this issue extensively, from the Secretary Blinken to National Security Advisor Sullivan and certainly the Asia coordinator Kurt Campbell, the senior director Edgar Kagan. This is an all-star team who have years of experience on this issue. So my interest in more is what is the policy review underway in Pyongyang.
Great, thanks Sid. Gene?
Well, don't we all want to know? That's a much harder question. But going back to the Biden administration, yeah, all those people that Sid mentioned are very experienced negotiators and thinkers when it comes to North Korea. And I think that that's going to be an asset. One of the things that the North Koreans were counting on with the Trump administration was that they would be able to pull the wool over the eyes, because you had all these people who didn't have much experience with North Korea, to be honest. And one of the beautiful things about being American, and I did it too, is that you think you can go in and do things that no one has ever done. And, you know, worked out somewhat in my experience in opening up a bureau, but it also means that we sometimes don't do our homework. We're a little bit of cowboys going into a place like North Korea, where they have the same people in place developing that policy for decades. And so if we don't do our homework, we are at a disadvantage. And so what the Biden administration has done is bring in people who have lived it. And so they won't be as easily snookered. So I think that that's, for me, that is a positive thing. I think that the challenge is that this is a very different situation. And I think, Avery, you mentioned this. It's a very different situation in 2021 when it comes to the nuclear program than it was 25 years ago, 20 years ago, and even in 2016 when President Trump won the election and came into office in 2017. Very different situation, far more developed, and we have experts here who are much more knowledgeable about what that means, but it just means that the negotiations are going to be even tougher. I think the thing about Pyongyang is that we have to be mindful that they're not operating like a government the way that ours is, in the sense that you have one person who is largely dictating policy in Pyongyang. So when we talk about a policy review, it's not the same thing in Pyongyang as it is in Washington. So what is best for North Korea, the people of North Korea, may not be the path that the leader of North Korea is taking.
Yeah, I think this, I mean, yes, I think it's all very interesting. That it is true. I think a lot of the people on this Asia team have had a lot of experience with this issue, right? I think Sid mentioned, you know, so Edgar Kagan was at the embassy in Beijing when we were doing 6-party talks. Dan Crittenbrink was also at the embassy in Beijing. Laura Rosenberger, senior director for China, was on the 6-party negotiating team. So it's a really, I mean, it's folks that know the, and as Sid mentioned, Jake and Tony Blinken and others, it's a very experienced team. Wendy Sherman, I mean, it's a very experienced team when it comes to this. And so I guess one of the questions for me there is, can they, because they know the issue well, can they, are they able to think outside the box, right? And I think one of the things that this discussion really made clear is that the North Korea issue and the direction in which it's going on the nuclear weapons side really creates these, you know, quite consequential knock-on effects for the U.S.-China relationship. And so I think it's very difficult to look at solutions to the North Korean problem or even make it raising the urgency of the issue between the U.S. and China because of the way in which it can impact the overall bilateral relationship. Okay, let's move to the next question. What is the net impact of Trump's years on convergence or divergence of agreement between Beijing and Washington on North Korea? Are the U.S. and China further apart or closer together on how to confront the nuclear issue? So on this one, can we just go, we'll go to each panelist and can you just give me like a very short answer. So are we closer or farther apart on North Korea after the Trump years? Avery? The U.S. and China, are we closer or further apart?
Farther apart.
Farther apart. Jean?
Oh, farther apart. I mean, the U.S. and China were much closer in 2016. And now it's there's a huge gulf.
Yeah. Dr. Zhao?
I'm afraid it's farther apart because of bilateral rivalry. Each country tends to prioritize geopolitical competition between themselves. But I think for the near term, there are opportunities for convergent interest. You know, Biden needs to think about sanction relief for North Korea to slow down its nuclear growth, and that needs buy-in from China. And also, you know, if Biden is going to focus on slowing down North Korea's nuclear development, it needs some North Korean commitment on the eventual goal of denuclearization, and that requires all the major powers on the same page and putting joint pressure on North Korea to clarify its thinking on denuclearization roadmap. So for Biden to make any progress in the near term to freeze and cap North Korean capabilities, it really requires Chinese cooperation. So for the near term, I think there are opportunities for achieving their convergent interests.
Great, thank you. Sid, do you want to say closer or farther apart?
I think if we are farther apart, it's not because of the way President Trump necessarily approached solely USPRC cooperation on North Korea. Dr. Chow hinted at this. It's within the broader context of the USPRC relationship. So that's the good news. Look forward. Let's see how that relationship develops under the new administration within the realm of the possible. And secondly, you know, the tensions, the difficulties that may exist are because of what steps Pyongyang has taken over the last 4 years. You know, not necessarily because, again, that the somehow we had a really productive cooperation with China up until 2016 that went away. That would be a misread of what we had accomplished prior to President Trump, and a misread of the core of the issues that we have difficulties with during President Trump.
Okay, great, all great answers. Next question. Even if the external security environment for North Korea were to become less hostile, should we be considering whether domestic factors such as Kim Jong-un's connection to North Korean elites would prevent him from trading away significant parts of his nuclear program or halting the development of that program? Sid, I think I know your answer to this, but I'll go to you first.
Yeah, we have no sense that Kim is under any pressure from interest groups within North Korea. I think Gene touched at this. You know, I threw out the term policy review kind of flippantly, knowing, of course, it was not an interagency process in North Korea. And frankly, not that the there's hardliners twisting Kim's arms. You know, I think even just from that small tactical development surrounding Hanoi, Kim showed how easily he could move the narrative in support of justifying the engagement of the United States, build the support for it. And then, and when he dropped the ball and it failed in Hanoi, how to shift it back. So, you know, the challenges Kim faces and why he needs a nuclear weapon, again, gets to the, not the, there's no external security threat to the DPRK. 67 years of armistice, Kim Jong-un has seen U.S. forces in Korea maintaining peace and stability, not invading the North like Syngman Rhee advocated. The real security challenges he faces are the frailties of the system. So that's more of a challenge, I think, for him to make a decision. You know, the nature of the system rather than it is concern about particular interest groups.
Jean, do you want to comment on that?
I was just going to say that I do think that Kim Jong-un or the Kim family has focused its investment on the power base, the elites in Pyongyang, to make sure that they have a certain level of a certain standard of living. And that has come at the expense of much of the rest of the country. This is an investment that he has made in his power base. And that if he doesn't have the tools that he needs to keep them happy, and that is assuring them a comfortable lifestyle, that it is gonna be, it could be tougher for him to maintain their loyalty because he's essentially buying their loyalty. And I sometimes wonder, you know, we've had a couple high level defections from the diplomatic ranks, which we would not, which would have been very unusual in years past. We had one of those, he was the acting ambassador to Kuwait for North Korea, who gave an interview with CNN just a few days ago or last week. So we're starting to see some of these higher level defectors who were very happy to stay tethered to Pyongyang because they had, were guaranteed a somewhat comfortable life. So I do wonder, it's hard for us to tell again, we're not there, we don't have much insight, but I do wonder sometimes at whether this, the inability to help them maintain a certain lifestyle. Remember, these are people who've lived overseas and know what it's like outside the country, whether that has been difficult for him to maintain.
Great. Thank you. The next question is on human rights. And so, but let me turn this in, let me first sort of adjust the question a little bit and ask Avery. So one of the questions is, how is the United States going to address human rights between North Korea and China? So the first part of this, I guess, to Avery would be, you know, to what extent do you think, you know, we heard virtually no discussion about human rights over the past 4 years. And to what extent do you think the Biden administration will return to more of a traditional human rights agenda when it comes to China, and to what extent that will, what sort of impact that will have on cooperation, potential cooperation in other parts of the relationship?
Yeah, it's a great question, because I do think this is actually something that's not gotten a lot of attention, but I think it's very important both in terms of the relationship with China, but also in terms of U.S.-Asia strategy more widely, and certainly with reference to North Korea, because it seems pretty, it was, you know, pretty clear during the campaign that the Biden team was going to put a greater emphasis on human rights and its foreign policy when it came into office. And certainly all the statements made during the confirmation hearings reinforce that. And I do think this is going to make it even, you know, I've said too many times, even more difficult to cooperate with China on a number of issues, and certainly on North Korea. So to the extent the United States is going to shine a light on human rights violations generally, but in particular in both North Korea and China, I have to think that that's going to complicate things. And certainly with Laura Rosenberger's role on the National Security Council, she's someone who's going to bring to that role a concern about human rights. So I think this is probably, let's put it this way, all signs point towards the Biden administration emphasizing human rights in its foreign policy and in relationship to China, and presumably with respect to North Korea, in a way that has not been true for quite a while, even before the Trump administration, because during the Obama years, human rights issues, certainly with respect to China, were downplayed as a consequence of some decisions made at the time that Hillary Clinton visited China when she was Secretary of State. So I do think this is going to be another complicating factor. It makes, it's a reason for pessimism about the possibility for cooperation with China and productive negotiations on North Korea. But having said that, it doesn't mean it's the wrong thing to do, because the United States may and apparently has decided that human rights is too important an issue to simply set aside in all cases.
Avery, while I have you, let me just allow a slight tangent, and that is to ask you, so human rights is, that will certainly complicate the relationship. Further complicating the relationship is climate change, right? And to what extent this administration will focus on climate change. John Kerry was on the Sunday morning talk shows as the climate czar or climate coordinator, talking about the potential for cooperation or collaboration, I think was the word he used, between the United States and China. So how do you see that fitting into this broader picture of all these different things pulling the U.S.-China relationship in different directions?
Right. I do think the incentive is there in the abstract, but concretely, I have to say that I'm also pessimistic on the ability to really make progress in the short term on climate change cooperation between the U.S. and China. Kerry, I think, will push for this, but on both sides, in the U.S. and China, there are going to be those who suggest that that any kinds of cooperation on climate change are also going to have to take into account the more fraught U.S.-China relationship, whether they're economic concerns, technology transfer concerns, whatever they might be. And I would think in terms of pressing issues where the U.S. and China claim in the abstract to be, have reason to cooperate, certainly the pandemic would be an even more pressing issue. And yet we see so little effort made to restore cooperation on dealing with the pandemic between the United States and China, not to mention other countries. So in the abstract, it seems like it should be that way, but I don't think it's clear that that necessarily means that something's going to happen. And of course, but I guess it was last week, a spokesperson in China, Zhao Lijian, the so-called wolf warrior diplomat, made his comments about, well, yes, there are issues on which we want to cooperate, like climate change, but that can't be completely detached from the overall state of the relationship. So I think there's going to be a lot of heavy lifting to do if the United States really wants to be able to do the kinds of things that need to be done on climate change and the pandemic, and that John Kerry says he would like to see done.
Thanks. And then Jean, and again, Sid, if you'd like to, the other part of this question was about U.S. policy on North Korean human rights under a Biden administration. I think the only time we really saw human rights talked about over the last 4 years was at the very beginning, in the first year of the Trump administration, where they brought back some of the detainees, including the UVA student Otto Warmbier. So Jean, what do you think will happen with Biden and human rights on North Korea?
I think we will see human rights being brought into the discussion. But I was just going to mention that the UK, Britain is an example of a country that does have diplomatic relations with North Korea. They have an embassy in Pyongyang, although I don't think it's staffed right now. But they also press North Korea on human rights issues. And so they have found a way to engage North Korea at the same time that they press them. And I've certainly been there at times in Pyongyang when they haven't been happy with the Brits because they've taken a particular stance on some human rights issue, but they let them stay and the Brits persevere. So I think that there are other countries that find a way to do it. So find a way to engage North Korea without sacrificing their principles. And I do think that that's something that is very important. One of the dangers, one of the things I saw with the summit diplomacy was giving Kim Jong-un, I am a supporter of engagement, but giving him a platform and normalizing his presence without addressing the egregious behavior that he is responsible for in Pyongyang. And we see little glimpses of this. For example, do you remember the shooting and the burning of the South Korean fisheries official, who we still don't know the full picture of what happened, but the brutality of how they handled the arrival of a South Korean, we still don't know what happened, but a South Korean fisheries official ended up perhaps on North Korean shores, and they, or I might have the details wrong, but they ended up killing and burning his body. And that, I think, is a little bit of a glimpse into the brutality of life in North Korea. And so it is really important that we shine a light on these things at the same time that we engage them. I don't think we should gloss them over. We're seeing the difficulty of this in the South Korean government's approach in how to deal with North Korea. But I think that you engage them and you're tough with them at the same time.
Right. Yeah, I think they shot, he was in the water and they shot him and then they burned him, right? They burned the body because they were worried about COVID, right? But yeah, it's something. Sid, I mean, I know this is a little outside your lane, but you human rights in North Korea?
Yeah, no, certainly, Victor. I was actually looking up some passages. I think Samantha Power made some powerful statements during her time at the UN that described the logic of why there's not an incompatibility of pursuing denuclearization and improved human rights. Jean's made a great point that this, you know, we cannot ignore the plight of the North Korean people. And, you know, it's hard to influence a regime from like North Korea from the outside, but it's not impossible. Robert King spent, you know, a number of years as special envoy, you know, pushing this effort, and it can make a difference. And I think, you know, the bottom line is, there should be no fear that, you know, an emphasis on human rights somehow undermines our larger policy objectives by adding an other complicated issue to one that exists. Certainly we can chew gum and walk at the same time. And I think we would gain Pyongyang's respect by showing our seriousness to that issue. And I say that not advocating the policy, but really in just judging how North Korea responds to how we handle this issue. It'll always be a talking point in their long list of hostile policy accusations. But I do not see, there would be no evidence that human rights would derail denuclearization in and of itself. Pursuing human rights would derail our efforts on the nuclear front.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point, that the notion that talking to North Korea, for the U.S. to talk to North Korea about human rights isn't necessarily an insult, but it's actually a commitment to the seriousness of wanting to transform the political relationship and even to provide economic assistance as part of a nuclear deal, because right now under U.S. law, we can't provide economic assistance to North Korea if there are all these violations along the supply chain. It would make it very hard for companies to do that. But let me ask, and this will be the last question to, based on this, to Dr. Zhao, and given your expertise on nuclear policy. And so I'm going to try to squeeze human rights into your area of expertise by asking you, I mean, is it conceivable that you could have a nuclear deal with North Korea that required the level of inspections, or at least negotiation on inspections and verification in a society as closed as North Korea is? So in other words, you know, I mean, the Iran deal or the India deal or these other deals always had as a part of them some sort of verification, inspection and verification regime that presumed that there was a degree of political openness, you know, maybe not, you know, it's maybe not complete openness, but a degree of political openness. Is it conceivable that there could be some sort of agreement with North Korea that had a viable inspections regime in a place that is as politically closed as North Korea is?
You know, certainly there were historical experiences of North Korea working with international inspectors to some extent. But I would think that it's extremely challenging to negotiate intrusive verification measures with North Korea in the near-term future. And that's primarily because of traditional suspicion of transparency in countries like North Korea and China. China is a much more open society than North Korea. And today, China wouldn't accept verification measures on arms control treaties with the United States. So it's going to take a long time to negotiate with North Korea. And I think, to answer part of the human rights question, I think the nuclear and the human rights is related in the sense that I don't think nuclear is the root problem. I think North Korea's deep isolation from the outside world is a very paranoid understanding about the international system is the root problem. Nuclear is just a symptom of the problem. So our eventual goal, I think, I'm very pessimistic about North Korea ever giving up its nuclear weapons, even after North Korea reforms and opens up. I don't think North Korea will give up its nuclear weapons by that time. But I think eventually we need to address the root problem of trying to transform North Korea into a more normal state that has a more nuanced and balanced understanding of the outside world. At that time, even with nuclear weapons, North Korea would feel less urgency to adopt destabilizing nuclear postures. So even with nuclear weapons, North Korea's nuclear threat to the region, to the world, will be much less. And in the same sense that, given our fundamental goal is to making North Korea develop a nuanced understanding about the outside world, I think the U.S. should, it makes sense for the U.S. to implement principled diplomacy, including its position on human rights, because we shouldn't change the outside world to fit with North Korea's expectation. But we should help North Korea understand the outside world as is. So in that sense, I think the principled diplomacy, including human rights, makes sense when dealing with North Korea.
Great, terrific. We are out of time now, and we've gone through most of the questions. Apologies to those who didn't get their questions fully answered. I tried to weave them into the questions posed to our guests. Really a fantastic, very rich and nuanced discussion. I found it extremely interesting. We covered a wide range of topics. Hopefully we capitalize on the expertise that each of you bring to the table. I want to thank Avery Goldstein, Jean Lee, Zhao Tong, and Sid Seiler for joining us this morning, this evening. I know Sid's got to get back to work, and Jean and Zhao Tong, it's very late in the evening, so thank you for joining us, and Avery and I have to start our day. So thank you again for joining us on this very special dialogue on North Korea and U.S.-China relations. Thanks to Georgetown Asian Study Program and the Georgetown University Initiative on U.S.-China Dialogue for holding this event. We all hope you enjoyed it, and have a good day, good evening.